On today's show,
Trey joins us live from the Bay to fill us in on the fallout from the Kevin Durant injury news.
From Toronto, Skeith projects how the finals will play out and also where Kyrie will end up this summer.
And as Tony Parker announces his retirement, we count down the best moments of his Hall of Fame career.
It's Wednesday, June 12th. The starter starts now! Welcome to The Starters, presented by Jack Daniel's Old Number 7 and Tennessee Honey. I'm Tass Mellis. Alongside me, it's the Aussie, Lee Ellis. J.E. Skeets will be joining us a little bit later from Toronto. Hopefully his hotel room is in order. But for now, Trey Kirby live at the NBA Finals. How you doing there, Trey?
Ayo!
Trey, we got to start with this right away. The Warriors' worst fears came true. Kevin Durant has a ruptured Achilles. He let the world know he has undergone successful surgery today on Instagram. In part, he wrote, quote, "I'm proud that I gave it all I physically could, and I'm proud my brothers got the W. It's gonna be a journey, but I'm built for this. I'm a hooper. I know my brothers can get this game six, and I will be cheering with Dub Nation while they do it." Trey, what's the feeling within the team now that they know the extent of KD's injury and have had a couple days to let it sit?
Well, there's no doubt Kevin Durant's injury is the first question and the first thing on everybody's mind. But I'll say that the Warriors, to me, felt focused. And just as loose as they have for any of their finals practices, they look like a team that knows that they have a big task at hand, but they still have a task at hand. It didn't feel like they had been crushed finding out that Kevin Durant does indeed have a ruptured Achilles and has had surgery for it. That being said, there's still a lot of confusion around. Today, Steve Kerr spoke about the clearing process for KD and how the Warriors doctors cleared him and a second opinion cleared him. His business manager, Rich Kleiman, cleared him, and KD himself cleared him. That being said, if they would have known how it all played out, he said, Steve Kerr, they obviously would have done things differently. It's a weird scenario because there's still some very important basketball games to be played, but this was the hugest news. So yeah, confused but focused, I would say, is the general feeling around the Warriors.
Yeah, watching media today, they definitely did seem focused, and they did mention KD's injury would be used as a motivational tactic. Do you think going forward they're going to use it as a bit of a rallying cry?
I think it's going to be part of their motivation. As Steph Curry said today, that's going to be motivation, but also the fact that they are still trying to complete a three-peat. They don't want to go out this way. Furthermore, this is going to be the last game in Oracle Arena, and they just lost the previous two. I don't think the Warriors want to go out with three straight losses in Oracle, but like you said, Tass, Kevin Durant not playing, that's definitely going to influence the fans. Klay Thompson said he expects the fans to be the loudest they've ever been for Game 6 here. So, yeah, it will be motivation, but it is a whole part of the motivation. There's a lot of different places where you can draw energy from, Steph said, and I think that's what we're going to see tomorrow night.
Trey, we know you're hanging out with the heavy hitters in terms of the media world, your Lowe's, your Windhorse, your Steins. So what's the vibe you're getting in terms of Kevin Durant's future outlook? Will teams still give him the max despite his injury status?
I think so. I think teams are still going to be itching to get their hands on Kevin Durant. You're going to miss out on a year of him. There's no doubt about it. But when he went down with his injury in the Houston series, everybody had agreed that Kevin Durant was the best player in the league. You're going to have to spend a year rehabbing him, whether that's here in Golden State or wherever else he ends up. But after that, you're getting 4 years or 3 years of one of the best guys in basketball. Furthermore, as a 7-foot guy with a wet jumper, you have to imagine that whatever loss of explosion, whatever loss of athleticism Durant suffers from having his Achilles repaired, maybe it can be mitigated a little bit by being a 7-footer with a wet jumper. I mean, Dirk Nowitzki is still playing at age 41. Kevin Durant has a lot of years left ahead of him.
He has many, many years left ahead of him. We were lucky enough, all of us, to be at Game 5, and I got to be there on the court watching him warm up. And not only is that jumper wet at 7 feet, but he moves so smoothly. And we were worried a few years ago about that Jones fracture in his foot and how that would slow him down. But he's only 30. He came back from that. I imagine he'll be just fine going forward. But let's talk about going forward in this series. The Warriors obviously won Game 5 and maybe stole momentum from the Raptors. But do you believe in that? Do you believe that momentum carries from game to game in this series?
Momentum came up a lot today at the various press conferences, and everybody agrees, yes, indeed, the Warriors do have the momentum. It's a question now of can they capitalize on it, because the advantages that the Raptors had coming into the series are still there. They have two chances to win one game. They're going to have another of those games at home, and as we know, Kevin Durant is not out. While the Raptors are currently peaking, Kawhi Leonard is playing his best basketball of the season. The team is playing more together than they have for the entire season. So, yeah, the Warriors probably do have a little bit of the momentum coming off a Game 5 win, coming back to Oracle. That being said, they got to find out how to capitalize on it.
It's a funny thing, momentum, though, because it was a one-point game and Kyle Lowry missed that jumper or got blocked at the end of it. So you could think that the Raptors would also feel pretty confident going in, of course, to Game 6, where they've won two games there already. I mean, did you sense any difference from the Raptors from their sort of motivation going into this game?
They didn't seem too tense. I thought the Warriors probably felt a little bit looser than the Raptors did, but, you know, I guess maybe the pressure is off the Warriors now. They just have to win to extend their season, whereas the Raptors are trying to wrap things up. I think that they are still trying to live in the moment. That's what they've been preaching throughout the finals. It came up in press conferences more today. Focus on the task at hand. Focus in the moment you're in. Yeah, it was a weird game in Game 5, and, you know, you blew your chance at winning the championship at home, but it would still be fun to celebrate, even if it's in America.
Yeah, live in the moment seems to be the Raptors' motto very much during these NBA Finals, if you're listening to any of these press conferences. Aside from the press conferences, did you get any one-on-one time with anyone, Trey?
Yeah, I got to speak with Andre Iguodala today. We talked about his defense on Kawhi Leonard at the end of Game 5 and also his earliest Oracle memory.
On the defensive end, you come in and double hard on Kawhi as you got the ball up at the top of the key. It seemed to me like you were trying to get a little bit to his right hand. Is that a scouting report thing? It seems like he takes a lot of sort of fadeaways to the right.
Well, that's another thing that, you know, we've learned from being in the finals so many times is that, you know, when you're talking about basketball, you can't give too much information when you're answering questions. So what we try to do, I'm reading Clay, not so much Kawhi, I'm reading Clay, like, I'm like, where's Clay's feet at? What's his positioning? Because I can run on the left side and double from the left. Because if we're trying to get Kawhi away from his right, Clay should be on the high side, right? So that doesn't give anything.
No spoilers.
So I just saw Clay's feet and the way they're positioned, and I said that was the best angle to take to double. It was just good timing on that one.
Game 6 is going to be the last game in the Oracle. What do you expect the atmosphere to be like?
Our last two games here were, like, incredible as far as the energy. So expect it like that. And you know, it's funny. We believe, you know, that's historically been a saying with the run that they made before. So, you know, we know they believe. And then they're going to be in here ready to roll, ready to go, and, you know, try to get a win the last game here.
Do you remember your first game in Oracle? I think it was January 05. Been a while.
Oh, yeah, I played good that game. I had a dunk.
19-9, if I'm not mistaken.
I didn't know that. I just know I had a dunk off my right leg, and I had to do that off in traffic. It was pretty good. It was kind of weird playing in here. You couldn't figure out the vibe quite, but I enjoyed the arena. Like, it feels smaller and more intimate, which is better for basketball. So it's like a shooter's arena, so I always like playing here.
All right, thanks a lot, Andre. Good luck in Game 6.
Best of luck in the future. I know y'all getting canceled. I'm sorry to hear that. When I retire, I may bring the show back when I run the channel.
All right, sounds good. I'll get you my information. Thanks a lot, man.
An endorsement from a future Hall of Famer. We got to change the sizzle reel. We got to add that on, Trey.
Yeah, it's big news, guys. Got something lined up in the future. Dre and Trey. Here we go.
All right. A few more years, Andre Iguodala. I mean, we may be unemployed for a few years until he's done, but at least we know we've got a job at some point. All right, Trey, we will check in with you tomorrow on game day. Thanks so much. And since Game 6 will be the last at Oracle, Lee asked fans outside it what they'll remember about the storied building. Right after this.
The Starters is presented by Jack Daniel's Old Number 7 and Tennessee Honey.
Welcome back to the show. Whatever happens in Game 6 at Oracle Arena on Thursday night, it will be the last basketball game ever played at Oracle. Before Game 4, I had a chance to speak to Warriors fans about their favourite memories from the Warriors' times there. Tonight might be the last game ever at Oracle Arena. It's possible.
Hopefully not.
Hopefully not for Warriors fans, of course. But if it is, What's one memory you have? What's something you're gonna miss about this place?
Definitely Baron Davis over Andre Kirilenko 2007. Even though we lost that series, that poster was probably the greatest play in Warriors history for me.
I became a Warrior fan during the 1987, the Sleepy Floyd game, when he scored 29 points in the fourth quarter, and I've been hooked since then.
29 points in the quarter and 51 in the game for Floyd.
Our three rings. We got three rings, we started off from the bottom, and now we're here. We get four, we're good with that. And I'm good whatever they want to do, because I'm a Warrior fan, Warrior girl for life, baby!
All these people, this is what I love. Yeah. All of us together cheering for our team. That's what I'm going to miss the most.
In 1967, the Warriors were supposed to play Wilt Chamberlain here, and because Franklin Muley rented the place out to a circus, it was played at the Cow Palace. So the most important game is the one that wasn't here.
Well, on my 30th birthday, 2 years ago, they won the finals, so that was pretty memorable.
That was a nice birthday present.
It was, 2017, yeah.
Did they give you a ring for it?
Still waiting.
you don't look a day over 25.
For me personally, I think it's just spending the time with my mom and just having this beautiful experience, just being with her, and whenever she takes me to these games, just always remember them. And when I'm older, I'll probably end up sharing them with my kids.
What sign have you got there?
The original, We Believe, 06-07.
What do you mean, the original?
Well, I'm the season ticket holder that started the We Believe campaign back in 06-07.
You started the campaign?
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
Wow, it really took off.
You can say.
I started coming here in the 80s, early 80s, and my favorite memory is just every team, no matter how bad we were, we're always competitive. It was always fun to be here, and we lost a lot of games, but it was always fun to be here. Great crowd, great teams, great coaches, and a lot of characters over the years.
That was great stuff, Lee. We're going to cry every block here on this show. All right, after the break, Skeets joins us from Toronto to give his opinion on how this series will play out. Stay tuned. Welcome back to the show. It's time for Check the Polls, where we get your opinion on the hot button issues. And we start with the finals. As bleak as it seemed after their Game 5 loss, the people out there, well, they believe in the Raptors to close it out. 47% of people believe the Raptors are going to win in 6, and another 24 in 7, only 29 for the Warriors in 7 games. Skeets joins us live from Toronto. Skeets, do you agree with these people?
Well, here's what this poll tells me. We have our fair share of Canadian Twitter followers, everybody believing here in the Raptors. And here's the other thing. We tell kids to follow their dreams. Well, we should also be telling kids to listen to their dreams, because you guys know this. I've been saying it on the air for a while now. I've had premonitions about the Raptors winning in 7, the NBA Finals. I got caught up in the Game 5 hype. We're in Jurassic Park. We're all making our predictions. Okay, it's 5. It is 7. It's always been 7. So I disagree with the results from the poll, but I do think a Game 7 actually favors the Raptors, and here's why. They're notoriously ugly. They're usually they're low-scoring, ugly affairs, and I think that benefits a team like the Raptors when you're playing a mighty offensive team like the Warriors. 2016 Game 7, Cavs-Warriors, 93-89. 2003, Heat-Spurs, pretty similar, 95-88. The Lakers-Celtics won Game 7. That was even uglier. Spurs-Pistons in 2005, even uglier than that. Low scoring, I mean. So I actually think the Warriors are going to pull out this Game 6 at home, their final game now truly in the Oracle. And it comes back here to Toronto. You guys fly back up. Trey flies back. And it's like it was always meant to be, listening to my dreams, of course, Raptors in 7. That's just how it is. That's how it ends. I'm telling you now.
That's a very, very reasonable, and probably the people voting in this poll see that Kevin Durant went down and just automatically think, well, they don't have Kevin Durant anymore, so the Raptors are going to win this series. I do like the fact that the Raptors kind of had a bad game in Game 5 from a lot of different guys and from the defensive end in terms of their Game 6 outlook, because they're so good that they won't have two bad games in a row. And they're a bounce-back team, especially defensively, as you said. But even Kawhi Leonard, yeah, he had that 10-point run, but he was 4 of 15 with 5 turnovers to that point. Kyle Lowry had a shaky first quarter before getting it together. Danny Green wasn't awesome. Fred VanVleet wasn't awesome. Up and down the roster, I didn't think they had a great game. So I could see them turning this thing around in Game 6, especially because Kevin Durant isn't there. And they can look back at the first four games of this series and play that way. They're going to go up against a conventional center. Marc Gasol lines up a heck of a lot better than he does against Draymond Green, who started Game 5. You don't even know if Kevon Looney is starting. So there's a lot of good things happening for the Raptors.
But you're forgetting about Game 6 Klay. That's a real thing. Klay was amazing in Game 5. He could be even better in Game 6. He's just got a great track record of performing in those Game 6 scenarios. So, I mean, you're right. The Raptors did not play their A game by any stretch of the imagination. They've even been better on the road, as they've proven. Both teams winning on the road left and right here in this series. But still, you know, you do have Curry and Klay, the ultimate equalizers from the three-point land. And, you know, I brought it up too. You know, you hit 15 threes, both of these teams, whoever gets to that mark, it's basically a lock to win. The 20, they hit 20 and they only won by 1 point. I hear you, but they could do it again. They easily, both Curry and Klay, could give you another 12 threes, 12 or more threes. They're that good. So, yeah, I just still think it's 7. I really, truly do in my gut.
One of my quick notes for Game 6 is, will Klay have a bad game ever? I'm just kind of expecting Klay to go a little bit left or a little bit right at some point in this series. But it's Klay. Klay has been absolutely money in this series.
Yeah, Klay has been brilliant, no doubt about it. But really what I'm interested to know, Skeets, is what's your plan for watching it tomorrow night? Have you got the Kyle Lowry jersey ready to go? I mean, you're going to be in Jurassic Park, I believe. Is that right?
I think I'm going to be in Jurassic Park. Yeah, they're going to put me there in case the Raptors do pull this off on the road so I can go party with everyone. I'm not going to likely go with the Lowry jersey. You know, it's not super warm here. I know it wasn't a great day in Atlanta as well. I'm going to have a sweater of some sort on. It gets pretty chilly here at night. So I'll just keep it simple. I won't overthink it. Got to worry about my skinny frame, you know, got to get some warmth going. Well, there'll be a lot of body heat. I get that in Jurassic Park. But if it's rainy again, which it is calling for in the forecast,
no.
It's going to be another Jurassic Lake there instead of the park. Yeah, I know. Not excited about that part.
All right, moving on to the next topic, away from the NBA Finals for a second. Kyrie Irving is a free bird. He will not opt into the final year of his contract with Boston, making him an unrestricted free agent. So we ask you, where will he end up? The majority of people with the Brooklyn Nets, 54%. The Lakers at 22%. The Knicks at 16%. And the Celtics, his current team, which he could re-sign with, fourth at 8%. Skeets, what's your take? Do you agree with this Brooklyn Nets pick?
Well, yeah, a couple things about this poll. 8% for the Celtics seems way too high, honestly. I know that sounds a little strange, and there's some hope that they could convince him to come back or stay at least if there was an Anthony Davis sort of trade. I get that, but I don't see it happening. The writing is on the wall. He is leaving. So 8% feels too high. The Nets at 54%, that feels right just because of sort of the momentum that the Nets have gained over the last couple of weeks with reports. And, you know, they look serious of beating these other teams like the Knicks to big free agents. They traded Allen Crabbe. They traded picks to open up more cap space to make a run at potentially two max guys. So that makes sense. I just find Kyrie to be such an interesting free agent when you look back at his season, because we all know he's amazing. You know, he's 24-7. He had great percentages through the regular season, both from the floor and from three. So on one hand, he's an all-NBA guy. We all get that. But on the other hand, he admitted to having difficulty being a leader. Some people think he even, you know, poisoned that locker room or turned them against each other. He did a poor job there. He dropped the ball in the playoffs. He was, quite frankly, brutal, 30% from the floor over those final four losses to the Bucks. So on one hand, we know he's really good. But then does he have sort of this black cloud hanging over him of this idea of him being a leader? Can he be your one guy? So I've always thought he's going to go to a team with another star player. And the KD injury possibly changes that equation, because I was pretty convinced they were going to team up, be it in Brooklyn or New York. But maybe that now changes with depending on what KD does, or maybe it doesn't at all. And Kyrie says, I'm here for 1 year without you while you're out, and then come back and we'll try and win a chip. But I think the poll results, outside of the Celtics being a little high, makes a little sense from what we're hearing from different people in different.
Yeah, Kyrie and LeBron on opposite coasts just kind of makes sense. I wouldn't mind seeing that happen. Skeets, we will check in with you tomorrow prior to Game 6 from your hotel room, maybe? I'm not sure.
No, I'm going to be in Jurassic Park. I'm tired of it. I've been sitting in this hotel room for 48 hours now. I'm so bored.
Well, order some room service, would you? All right. Coming up after the break, we count down the top five moments from Tony Parker's career. Stay with us. Welcome back to the show. With Tony Parker retiring, we decided to count down what we think are the top five moments from Tony's career. Lee, take us through them.
At number five, in the 2012 playoffs, the OKC Thunder upset the Spurs in six games. They met again in the Spurs home opener the following season, and Tony got a measure of revenge when he hit the game winner, the buzzer beater, to knock off the OKC Thunder. He also hit the three to tie this game up. So that was a good night for Tony.
I like how we have a mid-ranger in there.
That's
the prototypical Tony shot.
At number four, in 2009, Spurs and Sixers were tied. Philadelphia had the ball. San Antonio forced the turnover. Tony Parker went to Manu Ginobili for the shot. He bricked it, and then Tony just happened to be in the right place at the right time. And if, I mean, what is that? That's just a fling at the rim, but a good one. And he knocked it in and won the game.
Over the shot clock almost.
Yeah, great shot. In 2008, Tony Parker had a career night when he dropped 55 points on the Minnesota Timberwolves. He added 10 assists, shot 61% from the field. But Tass, this came in double overtime. Does that count?
Yeah. For Tony, I think that's totally fine. How many did he have in his overtime?
Like nine.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, we'll count it. Good job, Tony. At number two, game one of the 2013 finals, the Spurs were up two with about 13 seconds to go. Tony Parker almost lost possession, gets it back, throws it up as the shot clock is going off, banks it in, and puts the Spurs up four. They would go on to win this game. Look at how close he was there to losing possession of the ball, and then just gets it off.
Got the dribble alive there for a second, too. That was so neat.
Look at that. LeBron is right there on him. Just gets it off in time. Good job there, Tony. But at number one, in 2007, in the finals again, also against LeBron James, but this time the Cleveland Cavaliers, Tony Parker was a machine, averaged 25 points on 57% shooting, and became the first Spur other than Tim Duncan to win a finals MVP as the Spurs won in a sweep. Tony, later that summer, got married to Eva Longoria, too. Pretty good few months for him.
What a fact.
They're not together anymore, but, you know, he's retired now, so who cares?
All right, we learned a lot in that top five right there. We also learned a lot from Mark Stein today because he let us know the Anthony Davis trade talks are heating up again. The Lakers have apparently made a few players available, including Brandon Ingram, Lonzo Ball, and their number four pick, according to Mark Stein of the New York Times. But New Orleans has made it known it hopes to assemble a three teams or more deal before surrendering Anthony Davis. So what that leads me to believe is Brandon Ingram, Lonzo Ball, number four pick, that's not enough to get it done. They're going to need more, as Mark Stein reported. They need more teams involved.
For sure. They just don't want to give up Kuzma and Ingram, I think. They want to keep one of those guys.
You think Kuzma would be the deal breaker?
I think it could be, yeah. I think Kuzma's a fantastic player. I mean, Ingram is too, but I would take Kuzma out of those two if I had the choice.
I would pull that trigger in a second, even if both of them were involved. Lee, we had a fan sign.
The Chiefs. The Starters NBA TV show on NBA TV may be coming to an end, but my marriage to Happy Wedge is just getting started. We're getting Chiefs even in the finals.
Chief got married.
Good job, Chiefs.
Way to go, Chief. We'll see you tomorrow, 6:30 Eastern.